Moinsen, this is Sebastian, and I finally found my preferred method to remotely trigger my Sony Alpha. Let's have a look at the trigger options and why I ended up writing my own app for this. This video is primarily about the remote trigger app that I wrote. As usual, it is free and open source. But to understand why I ended up doing some recreational coding for a new app for this common task, let's first go through the different trigger technologies, because there are 5 different methods that I know of. So yeah, this is my first listicle. Here are my top 5 methods to trigger a Sony camera. For my use case, USB control is my least favorite method on this list. When I'm talking about remote triggering, I am thinking of taking pictures of my family with myself in it. Controlling the camera via USB means running a long USB cable from the camera to some device that can control the camera, like a laptop or a Raspberry Pi. And no, I neither want to carry such a setup, nor do my children have the patience to wait until daddy has set up his photo studio to take a vacation photo on the beach. That being said, I actually use USB control a lot, at home, because it offers full control over the camera. The typical example would be time lapses of my 3D printer that are synchronized to the print process, with Octoprint controlling both the printer and the camera. It's just not for the road. This is the traditional one, a simple cable remote. On Sony cameras, this also connects to the USB port, but it is just an electronic trigger without the need to support the USB protocol. This makes it easier for simple devices to offer the trigger functions for a wide range of cameras, like the cheap slider with which I recorded my CNC time lapses. The slider supports a wide range of cameras with a really simple trigger mechanism and only needs electrical adapters for different models. The downside is that it offers less control than USB. Just focus and trigger. But it is also the method with the most accurate timing. If you need to reliably trigger your camera at exactly the right moment, this is your trigger method, and what I used for my bullet time video booth to trigger the array of old Canon cameras. But in terms of this list, a cable option just is not practical. It only ranks higher than USB, since at least a simple button is enough at the end of the cable, and I would not have to carry my laptop. Wi-Fi control is probably the wireless trigger method that most Sony users are familiar with. Even my old NEX 5T had it, and on paper it sounds just perfect. You connect your phone wirelessly to your camera, get a preview image, can control many parameters, and can download the picture immediately. There even is an API documentation by Sony, and I used it to trigger my automatic photo trap from a Raspberry Pi. But the problem is, it only works when the camera is in the right mood. Whenever I try to use it, I spend several minutes fidgeting with my phone and camera, restarting the process, disabling and enabling Wi-Fi, rebooting and cursing until I finally get it to connect. At which point, my kids have lost all patience. Maybe it works better on newer cameras, but in my experience, the NEX 5T, the A5000 and the A6400 drive me crazy every time I want to use this feature. Also, Wi-Fi is just not designed for a quick, spontaneous connection with a single peripheral. It requires your phone to change its network configuration, and this takes a moment and affects more than just the camera app. My Pixel 6 can handle multiple Wi-Fi connections at the same time, so it does not have to replace my main connection. But still, the process is unreliable and frustrating, which is why I switched to the next option on this list almost 10 years ago. Another classic, the good old infrared remote. Long before I had kids, I bought my first infrared remote for my old NEX 5T, and I'm using one of those even today. You do not have to set up anything, you only need to carry a very light and thin extra device, and it just works. Only downside? Well, you have to carry an extra device, and it sometimes has difficulties in bright sunlight at larger distances. Also, since I switched from using prime lenses to a travel zoom, I sometimes have problems triggering the camera from certain angles as the lens obstructs the receiver. But still, I have used it for so long that I was surprised that I completely overlooked a 5th remote trigger option. When I was preparing a video booth for a friend's wedding, I was looking for a simpler combination of triggering video recording, showing a preview and downloading the recorded videos from my A6400. Let's just say not everyone has room for the bullet time video booth setup, and that research for a simple solution got a bit out of hand. But that is when I learned that my camera also supported Bluetooth, which the NX5T and the A5000 didn't. So, Sony actually has a Bluetooth remote, which I do not own, but several people have documented the communication, which is done via Bluetooth Low Energy. For the video booth, I simply paired the camera with the operating system and then I only needed a few lines of Python code to trigger the video recording. If you need that for your project, I will throw those lines into the blog post for this video. Just look in the video description. But this also showed me the advantages of Bluetooth over Wi-Fi for simple peripheral devices. Just think of any Bluetooth device that you use in your everyday life. A Bluetooth mouse, Bluetooth keyboard, the Bluetooth connection in your car, your smartwatch, or your Bluetooth headphones. Whenever you take out your headphones, do you open the corresponding app and wait a minute for it to figure out the Wi-Fi connection? No, you don't. You just put them in your ears and typically you immediately hear the chime that confirms that they're connected to your phone. So, that's what I wanted for my camera. Let me demonstrate. I turn on my camera and the remote control pops up in the notification area within seconds. I can now trigger the camera or ignore it if I do not need a remote trigger. If I turn off the camera, the controls vanish again. I have implemented this around the companion app feature for Android phones starting with Android 12. Being a companion app means that the app is not active at all, as long as the camera is turned off. Your phone keeps an ear open for new Bluetooth devices anyway, and when it sees the camera, it will launch the app's service, which is killed again as soon as the camera vanishes. So unless you have Bluetooth normally disabled, this will not use any additional resources when you are not using your camera. The app also has a remote control screen if you need it, but it also allows you to customize the buttons that are offered in the notification area. If that's not enough and you like to tinker around a bit, and why wouldn't you if you watch my channel, you can also allow external apps to trigger the camera through broadcasted intents. What this means is that you can configure other apps like Tasker to send remote control commands to my app and create all kinds of crazy automations and control your camera with any gadget. You can find more about this feature on my blog at There Ought To Be, with a link in the video description. As I said, the app is free and open source, and it has no ads. Just download it from the Play Store or via F-Droid. Search for Alpha Remote by Deacon or follow the links in the video description. Not sure if that Greek letter in Alpha Remote is any good for searching on either store, but you will get there. And with that, I'm out. Ciao!